want to shout a praise this morning, declaring the victory we have in Jesus, knowing that he's fighting for us.
God is fighting for us, pushing back the darkness, lighting up the kingdom that cannot be shaken. In the name of Jesus, enemies defeated, and we will shout it out.
Actually, go ahead and have a seat real quick. It's one of my favorite things we do around here at church. We're going to celebrate baptisms this morning. Woo-hoo! Amen. Testimonies of death to life, of coming in a relationship with Jesus. And here at Grace, we believe that baptism is a faithful step of obedience. Once you decide to follow Jesus, to give your life to God the Father, allow him to rule it, allow him to lead it all throughout Scripture, even Jesus. There was a step that said, I'm going to be baptized in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. It's just a declaration to friends, family, to our church that they've decided to follow Christ. We don't believe that your salvation happens because or when you're baptized, but we do acknowledge that there's a supernatural thing that happens when we share in the burial of Jesus, and we also share in his resurrection. There's a symbol, and there's the Holy Spirit moves and speaks. So we're going to hear some testimonies from some of our brothers and sisters. So let's welcome to the stage.
All right. Good morning, everybody. So my name is Nathaniel. So the first time, thank you. First time I heard the gospel, I was 15 years old. I remember the first time the Holy Spirit fell on me, I was 21. So today I want to be baptized to show others the extent of God's grace and mercy. I fell away from my faith at 23 into a life of drugs, alcohol, pride, misery. But still he receives us with open arms, so that's why I'm standing here today. So I just want to celebrate with you guys. Also, I want to thank Grace Church for over 125 years of hard work. And, you know, I wouldn't be standing here without you guys. I finally feel I found my church home. Most of all, I want to thank the four best friends any man could ask for. Josh couldn't be here today. Three others are standing there. We got Kelsey, George and Brandy. I met them all in recovery, and I wouldn't be here again without them. I just want to say I'm proud of each and every one of you, and I pray that God continues to reveal his love and truth to us.
Right. Oh. Hello. My name's Kelsey Wolf. And since becoming an adult and facing the many challenges that come with shaping oneself, I found a new relationship with the Lord that I hadn't thought possible before. 2021 is when my relationship became something new with the Lord, and it's been growing ever since. The more I talk with, argue with, trust in, walk with Christ in all the different moments of life, the more conviction that I gain that he's never far and his fingerprints are everywhere that I'm willing to look for them. I'm finally in a place socially, emotionally, spiritually that I'm surrounding myself with fellow believers, and I feel excited to actually declare faith and take my relationship to the Lord, or relationship with the Lord, to a whole new level. So thank you to my team of friends who are here and bumping their way through life with me, to my family for keeping each other close amidst all of life's struggles, and to Christ for placing me exactly where I need to be always.
I hope all is well with everyone. How y'all doing? All right, so my name is Dante McClain. Growing up, I always felt as if I carried the presence of God. As I grew older, I understood more as I read the Bible. Wisdom came strong, and I realized it was the Holy Spirit. I am so grateful to have the living God who is and who was and who is to come, and his living son, Jesus Christ. I am not perfect, I'm a sinner. I have done many sins, maybe like fornication, I lied before, stolen even if it was like a candy bar. I've been disobedient to my parents at times, double-minded to God, and I know better. I take full accountability in all of my actions. I thank God for giving me chance after chance. I thank Jesus Christ who died for my sins and lives and loves us all. I thank my mother for being as strong as she was and raising me. She's actually a real big help as well. I am the man I am today because of God is so good. I thank you all, and I thank Grace Church. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Rhonda Brown. I followed Jesus since I was a child. The older I got, the more important it became to do the right things. And as I look back, I can see so many instances where God was with me my entire life. Even when I didn't notice him, he was with me. I've been wanting to get baptized for a long time. I'm doing it now because I know God wants me to. If just for a moment I want to make a good decision, and he can look down and say, you made a good decision once. I want to thank all the people here at Grace who have been kind to me and influenced me over the years.
Good morning. My name is Brandy Brewer, and I started following Jesus at the age of 20. Today, I want to be baptized because I've made spiritual changes in my life, and I'd like to declare my walk with Jesus. I want to thank God for all my trials that brought me where I am today. Thank you, guys.
Morning. My name is George Frederick Segers III. I became a follower of Jesus as a young child, but in my adolescence, I began to lose my way because of drugs and alcohol. I now know that there's a power greater than myself. I realize that he is always there even when I wasn't looking for him. Now that I have found my way again, I want to make a declaration of faith showing to myself and to God that this is a new chapter in my life. And I too would like to thank Nate, Josh, Brandy, Kelsey, and Grant. Thank you.
What a great day to be alive. My name is Khalib Rahim. 20 years ago, I found myself yearning for the truth. So then I found myself searching for the light. I was thirsty, and Jesus quenched my thirst. I am being baptized to show that I want to keep God as my central focus and elevate how I follow him. He has been so good to me. So for him, I am motivated to be great. I love to thank my mother who has always shown me that God exists. And I thank my family and friends. I love you all for believing and trusting me to be a leader. And Shar, who has spiritually motivated me to be in this serene chapter ahead. And D6Ts for my blessed shirt. Thank you.
Louder than the earth. from the rising sun to the setting. Great is your
Isn't it wonderful to be in a room with others singing about the faithfulness of God? And his faithfulness to you is encouraging his faithfulness to me. Oh Lord, you're worthy.
And all the saints and angels, they bow before your throne. And all the elders cast their crowns before the Lamb of God. They bow before your throne, and all the elders cast your crowns before the Lamb of God. You were the other one. You were the other.
Exalted to be lifted up. And Lord, we ascribe worth to you.
Day and night, night and day, let incense arise. Day and night, night and day, let incense. Day and night, night and day, let incense rise. Day and night, night and day, let incense arise. Day and night, night and day, let incense rise. Day and night, night and day, let incense arise. Day and night, night and day, let incense arise.
praised, extolled, that you would be lauded. Lord, we exalt you. Would you enlarge our vision of you? Would you enlarge our capacity to see you as you are? Lord, we praise your name. We declare that you are faithful and that you are true. We declare, Lord, that you are gracious and full of compassion. Lord, we declare that you are merciful and abounding in steadfast love. We declare, Lord, that all your works are good. Jesus, we praise your name. And so, Father, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, that we get a chance to spend time in your presence together. And Lord, we come before your presence with singing. Come fashion our hearts towards you. And Lord, as we get ready to bring an offering to you, would you be exalted by our gifts? And would you bless both gift and giver? In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated.
Good morning, Grace. Good morning. Nice job. Love baptism? Yes. Very cool. Look, if you guys, if anyone in the room has said yes to Jesus and you haven't been baptized, it is the next obedient step for you. And I encourage you today, go to the information counter and just say, I want to do that thing I just saw. I want to be baptized, and we'll get it scheduled and set up for you right away. If you are new or newer at Grace, we would love to know that you're here. The best way to do that is to text hello to the number that's on the screen, or if you're more comfortable, you can just fill out the card in the back seat there that says I'm new and drop it off at the information counter. It's just a way for us to reach out to you and see if you have any questions, help you to navigate what can sometimes be a pretty confusing church. There's lots of stuff going on at Grace, and the best way to kind of track with all that is just to go to our website, gracewired.com, and just check out what's going on for every age group, every life stage. There's something going on, and we would love for you to plug in and participate. Today is Trunk or Treat, which I'm super excited about, and we expect thousands of neighborhood families to show up, not thousands of families, but thousands of people representing hundreds of families to show up. If you still want to put a car in there as a trunk, you can still do that, I think, if you just stop at the information counter. We had a goal of 50, and we have 48 right now, so we're kind of there, but we can squeeze a few more in if you want to do it. But we would love for you to come out and just be with the families and point them towards Grace and point them towards Jesus. It's just a wonderful opportunity for us, okay? All right, thanks. Phil's in. All right, why don't you stand up, find somebody you don't know, and welcome them to Grace.
Joy on. in the beginning.
Hey, every time we set out to teach through a book of the Bible, there is this reoccurring pattern that always surprises me, but at some point you would think I wouldn't be surprised by this, but I always sit down as a teaching team, we think through the series, we have a pretty good idea of where we want the series to go, we have some thoughts about the main themes, and this is how it's going to look, and every time we get into it, something different than we even talked about emerges. And like I said, I'm always surprised by that, but I shouldn't be. When I was thinking about this week, the passage of scripture that came to mind was Hebrews 4:12 that says, the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and spirit, to joints and marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. For the word of God is living and active. The logos of God is what that word is there. And I just want to remind you, this is the inspired word of God. And it has this ability to cut through, to penetrate our hearts, to bring things. So even if you've studied Genesis before, and I know some of you have, and if you haven't, that's great. But if you have, I encourage you to come to it afresh. Here's the deal. If you come to a passage of scripture or a book of the Bible with an ear to hear, right, and a heart that's ready to receive, even a passage that you know inside and out has the potential to do something new, for God to reveal something new in you as you go. And so as we got into Genesis, the theme that has emerged through almost every one of the sermons so far, and for me in particular, is the theme of the grace of God. The creation story this time through for me is more about the grace of God than anything else. The grace of God for Adam and Eve, that God creates this perfect place, right, and gives Adam and Eve a perfect purpose, not because they did anything, right? They didn't earn it. They didn't get the merit badge or anything, but God does it for them. It's a gift, right? The fall itself is more a picture of God's grace than I've ever seen before. Before Adam and Eve have the opportunity to repent, God comes to the garden. He searches for them. He calls them out of hiding. When we talked about Eve, before Eve ever confesses her sin or maybe even recognizes the size of her sin, what does God do? God says, hey, I know that you messed up, but out of you is going to come the Savior of the world. It's this beautiful picture of God's grace. Last week, Wayne did a great job of talking about God's grace even towards Cain, the murderer. Right? And there's just this picture, grace, over and over. And grace is a powerful force, right? Get this. Grace is the distinguishing characteristic between Christianity and every other world religion, right? It's a difficult concept for us to wrap our minds around, but it is the distinguishing difference. So if you have those people that come to your door that's part of the Jehovah's Witness and they're knocking on your door, I can guarantee you if you can get them into a conversation about grace, it's going to be difficult for them to reconcile that. If you have friends that are Muslim, grace is an incredibly difficult topic for them to receive. How could God just forgive all the bad that I've done? I must have to earn that. And this is true whether it's the Mormons or Buddhists or Hindu, whatever it is, there is always a heavy emphasis on working to earn something from God. And Christianity says, no, you can't clean yourself up, right? You can't do anything to earn God's favor. He's already done it. While you were a sinner, Christ came for you. Right, and that is the ultimate picture of grace. So as we work our way through Genesis, I just want to keep bringing that back to you, and I want you to look for that that picture of God's grace, because we're going to see it in every one of the characters. We saw it in Adam and Eve. You're going to see it in Noah here pretty quick when we get to that story, and Abraham and Sarah and Isaac and Jacob and Joseph. They're all stories of God's grace. So I want to remind you, there is way more than we can talk about on Sunday mornings. And if you want all that God has for you as we go through this series on Genesis, buy the journal. We've made it very affordable for you. Be in the text during the week. Read through it. Take notes. Every time you open it up, ask God to reveal something new to you. The Word of God is living and active, right? So be engaged with the Word. But come on Tuesday nights, too. We got this wonderful group of teachers who are taking people deeper in Genesis. So they're going to teach deeper on chapter 5, which I'm going to preach on today. Each week goes a little bit deeper. That's at 6:30 on Tuesdays. If you have children that need childcare, we have childcare. You just need to register the children so that we know how many people to have to take care of them. But if you don't have kids, just show up. And show up at 6:30 to check into one of the... Yeah. Yeah, because that person needs more people at his table or her table. All right. Grab your Bibles, turn to Genesis chapter 5. If you didn't bring a Bible, there's one under your seat. If there's not one right under your seat, there's one in the seat beside you. We're getting kind of low on Bibles because people keep taking them, because I keep telling them if you don't have a Bible, feel free to keep one. So if you don't have a Bible, feel free to keep the one that's under your seat as a gift from us. If you are online, thank you so much for joining us. You too can swing by the church anytime, and we would be really excited to give you a Bible as well. So why don't you stand with me as I read Genesis chapter 5, and I want you to listen to the rhythm of the reading of this, and you're going to see that we go through a genealogy. Everybody gets excited when we're going to teach you a genealogy on Sunday. Yep. But you're going to see a pattern. It's repeated person after person, except for one exception. I want you to just see the exception. So Genesis 5, this is the book of the generations of Adam. When God created man, he made him in the likeness of God. Male and female, he created them. And he blessed them, and he named them man, or mankind, some translations say, when they were created. When Adam had lived 130 years, he fathered a son in his own likeness after his image. So the image of God is being passed down, and he named him Seth. The days of Adam after he fathered Seth were 800 years. He had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days of Adam lived were 930 years, and he died. When Seth had lived 105 years, he fathered Enosh. Seth lived after he fathered Enosh 807 years. He had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days of Seth were 912 years, and he died. When Enosh had lived 90 years, he fathered Kenan. Enosh lived after he had fathered Kenan 815 years. He had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days of Enosh were 905 years, and he died. When Kenan had lived 70 years, he fathered Mahalalel. Kenan lived after he fathered Mahalalel 840 years, had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days of Kenan were 910 years, and he died. I think you're starting to see the pattern. When Mahalalel lived 65 years, he was very young, he fathered Jared. Mahalalel lived after he fathered Jared 830 years, had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days of Mahalalel were 895 years, and he died. When Jared had lived 162 years, he fathered Enoch. Jared lived after he fathered Enoch 800 years, had other sons and daughters, and thus all the days of Jared were 962 years, and he died. When Enoch had lived 65 years, he fathered Methuselah. Enoch walked with God after he fathered Methuselah 300 years, and he had other sons and daughters. Thus all the days of Enoch were 365 years. Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. When Methuselah lived 187 years, he fathered Lamech. Methuselah lived after he fathered Lamech 782 years, had other sons and daughters. Thus all the days of Methuselah were 969 years, and he died. When Lamech had lived 182 years, he fathered a son and called him Noah, which is what we're setting up, the story of Noah to come in the next few weeks. And he said, out of the ground the Lord has cursed, and this one shall bring us relief from our work and from the painful toil of our hands. Lamech lived after he fathered Noah 595 years. He had other sons and daughters. All the days of Lamech were 777 years, and he died after Noah was 500 years old. Noah fathered Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Lord, thank you for the scriptures. Thank you that they are alive. Thank you for the genealogies. Thank you for what is history. Thank you for giving us the truth of your word. Our prayer every Sunday is that those who come in this room, those who are online, would hear a word from the living God. Because we believe that with just a word, everything can change. And so I ask, whether it's through my words or through the songs that we sing or a conversation in the lobby or a testimony from the baptisms, I pray that you would use any one or a combination of those things to speak a word to each person individually. I thank you that you are a God who sees us, who knows us, that you know every hair on our head, that you knit us together in our mother's womb, that we are uniquely created. I just pray that you would speak to each person. Any words that I say that are not of you would just fall away. The ones that are from you, from your spirit, would land in fertile soil, that they would take deep roots and they would bear fruit a hundredfold. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. So there's nothing like sitting down at the beginning of the week with your assigned chapter and reading a genealogy and thinking about how am I going to carve a 30-minute message out of a genealogy. But I want you to know something. There is more in chapter 5 than we can possibly cover in the next 25 minutes. So again, I encourage you to come on Tuesday nights, go a little bit deeper, be in the Word. So with the season that we're in mind, I've decided to name this sermon, The Addams Family. Right? Seems to work. So to understand the chapter 5, we have to understand the broader purpose of Genesis. And I talked about this week one, but I want to talk about it again. Genesis is the preface. Genesis is the introduction, really, to the rest of the Bible, but it's specifically an introduction to the Exodus story. It is written to the people, the Israelites, who have left Egypt, and it's written for the purpose of telling, this is who you are, this is where you've descended from, this is who God is, this is what God has called you to do. It is helping them to understand, why are we in this desert? Right? Why are we in this wilderness? What is God up to? And so Moses, being inspired by God, is writing the story to tell them, this is who you are, this is where you came from, this is who God is. It is a preface or an introduction to the story of Exodus, right? It's letting them know that they are chosen. It's telling them, this is your bloodline, right? And it's one thing to hear, hey, you are chosen. It's completely different when you see the bloodline, when you hear the stories of God's faithfulness, when you can actually hear and understand all that God has done to preserve you and to keep you there. Knowing your story and knowing the narrative makes all the difference when it comes to knowing God, who he is, and what he's done in your life. Taking the time to look back and remember is a major part of the Old Testament. Over and over, over 200 times we're told in the Old Testament to remember. Well, you can't really remember what God has done unless you first see what God has done, right? And so this is Moses' way of saying to the people, this is who God is, this is what God has done, this is your bloodline, and this is what you need to remember as you go through your life and walk with God. So knowing your narrative makes all the difference. So we have a 6 to 7 month discipleship process here at Grace called The Journey. One of the major elements of The Journey is that people that participate in it have to write their narrative and share their narrative with the group. And while that sounds, well, actually for some of you that doesn't sound easy, others are like, no big deal, it's always a big deal. And what we're doing is we're helping them to see where God was in their lives even before they knew who God was. Like, you start to realize that God has had his hand in life, that God has chosen me, that God, and the more you know your own narrative and the more you see God's hand in your life, the more you're able to rest in the fact that God is going to have his hand in your life going forward. So the book of Genesis, Genesis 5 in particular, is history, right? It's clarifying who they are, their bloodline, and what they are called to do. There's these clear applications that come out of the chapter that we can identify here in just a minute. But here's what I want you to hear. The important element of clarifying identity and purpose, you got to know your narrative, but if you want to clarify identity and purpose, you have to deal with the false indoctrinations, right? The things that you believe about God that aren't true, you need to unlearn those things so that you can learn those things about God that are true. Like believing something that isn't true about God will derail what God wants to do in your life. Tozer says this, what comes into your mind when you think about God is the most important thing about you. Our view of God, our understanding of God, it shapes our decisions, it shapes our reactions, it shapes the way we move towards other people, right? So the Israelites who fled, they had these deeply held convictions or understanding. They were deeply influenced by the Egyptian culture and the Egyptian religion. And we see that in the Exodus story, right? But the Egyptians were deeply influenced by a culture called the Sumerians, right? And in the 19th century, archaeologists began to discover these incredible archaeological finds about the Sumerian people that predate Moses, predate Egypt, right? And since those discoveries, this people group, these Sumerians, they are actually credited with inventing time. They are the first to have that a day is 24 hours, that it's divided into 12 hours for day, 12 hours for night, that they were the first to have the 60 minutes in an hour, 60 seconds in every minute. That all came from this culture that predates Moses, that predates the Egyptian Empire. They were the first, to, as far as we know, to have schools. They're kind of given the credit for being the first real governmental systems, architectural structures of large degree, irrigation, right? And what they've also discovered is that this Sumerian culture had their own version of the flood story, right? But these are all of the stories that have been passed on to the Egyptians and then passed on to the Israelites as well. We know from ancient texts that they had their own creation story. I talked about that in week one. So there's the other thing they were taught is that there was a line of kings. So think about what I just read, and then listen to what I'm about to say. They were taught that there was a line of kings that the pharaohs came from, and that some of those kings lived and reigned for tens of thousands of years. Right, and so Moses is sort of setting the record straight. He's saying, no, this is what you've been taught, this is what you've learned, but this is the truth about who God is and the kings and his path. And here's what the point was, right? And we see this over and over in when we look at the history of mankind. So the Egyptians say to the Israelites, we are royalty and you are less than. Right, so we have a legitimate right to oppress you because we are royalty and you are less than. If you just pay attention to human history, this is the story of human history. People who have power will find a way to convince those that they oppress that they are entitled, that there's something more about them than others. You see it now in different places in the world. It's just part of history, right? So this is what Satan wants to do. He either wants you to believe that you're superior and you have the right to oppress somebody else, or he wants you to believe that you're inferior and someone has the right to oppress you. When the scriptures say, guess what? And this is where chapter 5 starts. You are created in the image of God. All of you are created in the image of God. And then he says, love one another, serve one another, right? Submit to one another. That's the kingdom way. It's not about superiority. It's not about oppression. So Genesis 5 is this beautiful messianic line of Adam's family tree. It's just one line of the family tree. They keep saying they had other sons and daughters. We're not talking about the other sons and daughters. We're just talking about the line in the family tree that leads to Noah, eventually leads to Abraham, eventually leads to and takes us all the way to Genesis. And here's the deal. There's a ton of debate. You can find countless commentaries that have different opinions about the ages. Were they really 900 years old? Was there a different way of measuring time then? And I'll be honest with you, I don't care. It doesn't change the gospel at all, right? It really doesn't. And I do believe that the lifespan has gotten shorter. I do believe that they live longer. I don't have any reason not to believe that they were in their 900s and that Methuselah really was the oldest guy that ever lived. There's no reason for me not to believe that. But again, it doesn't matter. It doesn't change the gospel. And don't make that an issue worth fighting over, for sure. But it is worth noting, if the measurement of time is consistent from Adam all the way to Lamech, which is Noah's father, that Lamech knew Adam. Just think about that for a minute. Lamech, Noah's father, knew Adam. Right? So embedded in this genealogy are a couple really wonderful applications for us, and that's what we're going to try to pull out here in the next few minutes. So let's look at verse 1 and 2 first, and it says, "This is the book of generations of Adam. When God created man, he made them in the likeness of God. Male and female, he created them, and he blessed them and named them man or mankind or human when they were created." He goes back to the very basic, important truth, right? Over and over in the first five chapters, it is written, God created you. God created Adam. God created Eve. There's this reminder. Not only are you created, but you're created as an image bearer. Overarching message of Genesis is you are purposefully created to be purposefully creative in all that you do. You have divine identity and you have divine purpose. Your very existence is an act of a loving God. And Moses says, remember, God created you, male and female. Gender was God's idea. God created you male and female, and together you represent and you are the bearers of image. So chapter 5 stands in stark contrast to chapter 4. If you were here last week, Wayne did an incredible job. But both of these chapters identify a branch, if you will, of Adam's family tree. Right? In chapter 4, it is a portrait of the growing, what's the best word? The growing power of generational sin, right? So we see in chapter 4 and chapter 5, two people, both with the same name, the name Lamech. One is Noah's father, but the other one is the one that Wayne talked about last week. So Lamech number one ends up being a murderer like his forefather Cain was a murderer, and he ends up taking vengeance into his own hand. It's this growing power of generational sin, something for us to pay attention to. But then you get to chapter 5, it says, this is what sin has done. Chapter 5 says, this is God's redemptive plan to set things right. This is his response to sin, right? And so we go through chapter 5, you get to the second Lamech. Remember, there's two different people, same name. Second Lamech, who's Noah's father. And Noah says of his son Noah, this one shall bring relief. Now, no doubt that the relief, actually Noah's name means reset. No doubt that the reset or the relief plays out much different than Lamech probably thought it would. I don't think when he said that, he was thinking, I think God's going to send a flood and everybody's going to die. Right, but he was saying that there's something about this son of mine that is going to be a part of resetting, be a part of bringing relief to the world. Chapter 4, growing power of generational sin. Chapter 5, God's plan to address sin. I'm going to go through this really fast, but you can go back and look at it later. If you look at the names of this branch of the family tree, I find it to be really fascinating. Adam means human. Seth, right, which is the messianic line, means substitute. Seth is a substitute, not just for Cain, but he's a substitute, but he becomes the line in which the substitute, Jesus, dies in our place, right? So Seth means substitute. Enosh, just another name for human. Canaan is a variation of Cain. But then look how these start to go. Mahalalel is praise of God. Jared is servant of God. Enoch, dedicated, trained for God. Methuselah, we're not 100% sure, but it probably means something like man of rest. Lamech means strong from youth. Noah, as I said, means rest or reset. And then you have Shem, of great reputation or fame. God is setting in motion the plan of redemption. So, chapter 5 would not be complete if we didn't stop, hit the pause button, and talk about Enoch. So if you're using your journals, if you're underlining in your journals or your Bibles, I encourage you to underline, star, write in the margin, whatever you got to do, verses 23 and 24. Very important. 23 says, these are all the days Enoch were 365 years. Verse 24, Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. If this were in the scriptures, not in the context that it's in, we probably would assume that this means that Enoch died. But as you noticed when I was reading, every one of the patriarchs, everyone in this family line died. It actually says, and they died. But we get here, and Enoch doesn't die. He literally is taken up to be with God, right? So the beauty of this is, and it's really a theme that runs throughout Genesis, is walk with God. Good things happen when you walk with God. One of the baptism testimonies was I want to walk with God. Your blessings come when you walk with God. The kingdom actually comes closer when you walk with God. And the Israelites are being told two things. They're being told, you are royalty, this is your line, right? This is your family tree, and this is your purpose. Your purpose is to walk faithfully with God like Enoch walked faithfully with God. What I love about the word walking is it's this picture of intimacy, right? And what is he saying? He's saying you are created by God, and God is not just great, this great force that's out there. He desires to know you personally, to walk with you personally. God wants to walk with you and talk with you. Walk with God. Now think about the story, even as far as we've gotten so far. Adam and Eve are in the garden. They have had regular occasion to walk with God. It says they hear the sound of God in the garden walking, which they would have heard before. They probably would have anticipated that, run to him in the cool of the evening, walked with him, had great conversations with him, but they sin. And what do? They hide in their sin. They hide in their shame. And when they hear the sound of God in the garden, they don't run to him. They stay hidden. Now God comes and he finds them. But there is this contrast, right? Adam and Eve don't walk with God. But Noah, as we get into that story in a couple weeks, is credited with walking with God. Abraham is credited with walking with God. Joseph is credited with walking with God. And here's what I want to say this morning. I've been thinking about this. This has been the main thing I've been thinking about since I got up early this morning, is it's hard. It's not complicated, but it's not easy. Right? And there's a difference. Like, it's not hard for me to tell you what you need to do in your life to walk with God. It's harder for me to inspire you or for you to be inspired. I actually think what we saw today in the baptism tank is a beautiful display of people saying, I am going to walk with God. They're making that confession before you and the people. I am going to walk with God. Now, our job as a church is to come alongside, to inspire, to teach, to create environments where walking with God can happen. I will tell you, it involves Sunday morning, but it involves getting connected beyond Sunday morning. We also saw that in the baptism testimonies, like community matters. What do I say all the time? You cannot walk faithfully with Jesus in isolation. So walking with God, it's not complicated. It's not easy, but it's not complicated. I got a quote here from Oswald Chambers. He says, it is painful work to get in step with God and keep pace with him. It means getting your second wind spiritually. and learning to walk with God, there's always the difficulty of getting into his stride. But once you've done so, listen to what he says. The only characteristic that exhibits is the very life of God himself. The individual person is merged into the personal oneness with God, and God's stride and his power alone are exhibited. Walk with God. We're here to help you to do that, but part of it is you have to make the commitment. Right, you have to say, I want to walk faithfully with God, and then lean in to the ways in which we'll come alongside you and help you to do this. Most of that wasn't in my notes, so give me a second to figure out where to go next. All right, the passage says, Enoch walked with God, and at the tender age of 365 years old, he was not, for God took him. I was struck this week in my study time, that he actually was young in comparison to everyone else. In some cases, he was a third as old, or just a little bit more than a third as old. So put it in perspective, 25, 30 years old, right? In comparison to the other patriarchs that are part of this family line. Yet it's not a story of tragedy or sorrow. Right? He was young, but it's a story to be celebrated. For God took him is a good thing. And here's what I believe Genesis, the point Genesis is making. There is something more. There is something better. There is something of higher value than long life. Do you believe that? Like, do you really believe that? Like there's something more valuable than living to the ripe old age of whatever that is. Life in eternity with God is the carrot. It's the goal, right? Something of ultimate value that's actually worth giving your entire life to is beyond the grave. For those who are faithful, Enoch walked with God faithfully, and then he was no more. This is what the sons of Korah were writing about in Psalm 49 when they said, but God will redeem me from the realm of the dead. He will surely take me to himself. That take, took, same word. Going to be with God is glorious, and it's something to be celebrated. Let me say that again. Going to be with God is of great worth. It's something to be celebrated. But I can tell you, as I wrote my sermon, there was a sense of trepidation even saying that, with friends who are here that I know are grieving great loss. It feels almost insensitive to me, to those who have lost a loved one, to my friends who have had to raise their children without one of their parents, or to parents who don't get to see their babies grow old. But my hope is that the story of Enoch would be a reminder that there's hope. Right, that the truth to hold on to is worth holding on to amidst the sadness. The reality of the better that awaits us doesn't take away the bitter that confronts us. Scripture says we mourn, but we mourn with hope. Verse 24 says, Enoch walked with God, he was not, for God took him. And that is a glorious, awesome story. Genesis 5 exists to remind the Israelites. It's there to remind us that there is a rich reward for those who walk faithfully with God. Chapter 5 sets up God's plan to save the world, the family line that it's going to come through. It's going to set up our story of Noah, which we'll get into in a couple weeks. But it's a story of God's grace and God's relentless pursuit of us. It reminds us that in Jesus, you are royalty. Amen. Right? In Jesus, you are royalty. And that you are equipped to do the things that God has called you to do. He will never leave you or forsake you. And this is true whether you are a student or a teacher, whether you're the boss or a coworker. This is true for you as a neighbor. It's true for you as a parent. It's, It's true for you as a friend, that you are called and equipped to bring the kingdom of God into every relationship you have. Wherever you go, whatever you do, walk with God faithfully. You have divine identity and divine purpose. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for the genealogy. I thank you for the reminder of the power of walking with God. You actually desire to do more than we can ask, think, or imagine according to the power of the Spirit that's in us. The same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead is in each one of us. We are royalty when we say yes to Jesus, and we are called and equipped to bring the kingdom in every relationship we have. Help us to be that kind of people. Help us to walk with God faithfully and see you do more than we can ask, think, or imagine. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. We have a few things to share that we heard before the service. We have a group of people that pray a half hour before the service. If you ever want to join them, they meet in the chapel. And part of that is just listening. We believe that God speaks. We believe that he speaks individually. We believe that he speaks to us as a church corporately. So people go into the room. They pray. God wants to lift depression from someone in the room. Or maybe online, God wants to give hope to someone who has received a medical diagnosis and is feeling overwhelmed by that. Someone is suffering from some eye issues. God wants to bless someone's marriage. No doubt about that. And God wants to encourage someone's thinking about going on their next mission trip. Speaking of which, the team is back from Morocco. Welcome back. So if any of that resonates with you, we have a wonderful group of people that would meet down here with you that are trained and equipped to pray for you. If you have a physical need, spiritual need, a little bit of both, we'd love for you to join us. If you're online right now, we encourage you to call during the week. Ask for one of the pastors. We would love to pray for you as well. God bless you. Come back next week as we get into the very beginning of chapter 6.